hasn't done too much of an introduction, because one of the things that I find is that when parents ring me up having spoken to Aspire on the phone, it's kind of like I can walk on water. It's a hard act to follow always. I do have a great deal of difficulty explaining what I do. I'm going to try and do that in the talk. A lot of the things I'm going to talk about today, I haven't actually talked about publicly before, so it's a bit nerve-wracking. I have that kind of blank brain feeling before you get before an exam, where I've read all the slides, I've written out what I want to say, I have notes, and still I can't remember anything. So hopefully it's going to come out in some order, all the things I thought I was going to say. One of the first questions is why expression? One of the challenges I have is that I don't really fit into a box. I don't really identify with just being a teacher. Hello, yes? My problem is I talk with my hands, so hopefully I'm not going to wave this around like a baton. So how's that? Is that working?
No.
Is that working?
Yes. Yes.
Great. Okay, so I need to not bang it with my rings. Can't think of anywhere to prop this up even, so okay. Does it sort of work from down here?
No.
Great, okay, great. I'll try not to wave my hands.
Higher, I think.
Okay. Are we here?
Yes.
Great. Right, fine. I'll try and do that. So expression, why expression? One of the things I've found is that you can have a fantastic personality, you can have great talents, you can have great aptitudes, but if you can't express them, none of it is any use to you. And it's much easier to get results with people and much quicker if you can give them a way to express themselves. Those are quite specific to each personality. And it's much more palatable for me to talk to people about their personalities. Anyone who's in the room who's read one of my reports will see that it has a very different focus to other reports that you've got from other specialists. And one of the things I try to do is to set out a roadmap for people. One of the other questions I'm asked is, why is there four projects? The history of this is in that in 2009, it's 7.5 years ago now, I took the brave move of opening a school on the main street of Manchester. And for me, it was like a lab space. I wanted to prove all the wacky ideas in my head. And I did a number of things that were quite different. The first was that I interviewed all the students and set them up to work with me. I felt that you actually needed to understand who people were and the way that they worked in order to put them in a room and get the best out of them. And that you almost needed to kind of, I suppose, make promises to people and to then keep them, that was a very important thing to do. As the project went along, I realized that there was some pretty significant results coming out of it. Within the first 2 years, I realized that I needed to start documenting them. And so on the side, I set up the Purple Learning Project with a view to that being, I suppose, an international project and one that would live on and wasn't just about the people that I was currently working with. In 2012, I took the very brave move of deciding that I was becoming marooned in Blanchestown. People were travelling from huge distances, from the south side of the city, from County Meath, from County Kildare. Every time I did a radio interview, particularly on the topic of homework, seems to be the one that haunts me, I would have a lot of people phoning me in from very rural parts of Ireland, and I would not be able to support them. And typically, as things happen, you know, because situations come about, a friend of mine in County Wicklow wanted me to help her child. And I suddenly realised I didn't have a programme for her to work with her kid at home. And a big part of the homework club, the challenge I had was that a lot of people saw it as a grind school, which I really hated. And there was a big part of the puzzle missing for me in that I didn't know what was happening in the family. I didn't know the sort of generational history. There was a lot of missing parts to the nuggets in terms of taking research forward. And so I closed the doors of the homework club, much to everybody's shock, and I started a confidence club with the focus of me working much more intensely with people in the beginning. I would only spend 90 minutes with people, and then we would set up a program either to work in people's homes or the team would work online or in person with people directly. And that's just gone from strength to strength. So we now have students in every county in Ireland, and we have students in the UK, the US, New Zealand, Australia, and a few others that I can't think of off the top of my head, but those are the predominant countries. And now, I suppose the shift last year was I'm starting to team those people up and actually have them work together. And I'm quite excited about the idea of making people work in different countries. The homeschooling one was really just a case of me establishing what we've already been doing. And from the outset in the homework club, very quickly ends up with a spectrum of ages to work with. I currently work with people from 4 to in their 60s, and I'll talk about that later in the talk, the benefits of that. But a lot of those people had left formal education, and sometimes the homeschooling is a route back into formal education, and sometimes it's a route to a different type of life, which, and I do attract a lot of rare personalities, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that as we go on as well. So for me, the Purple Learning Project, there was an element in that it's the perfect environment versus the non-perfect. When I set up the homework club, I was completely in control of space. We ran the classes the way I wanted to run the classes. I put the people I wanted to put in a room together. And everything I do is planned, you know. And I don't make any bones about that. The sort of staff I picked, I'll talk about that too, why I picked them and the sort of nuggets I was looking for them. But everything was in my control, and it was the perfect space to work with people. The Confidence Club and the homeschooling aspect is the non-perfect environment. I no longer have all of those elements, and there's so many things beyond my control, but I wanted to be able to take the methods to people and for them to get results regardless of the sort of world they were in. Because I realized very quickly that if you spent an hour with us doing a subject in the homework club, that it impacted all sorts of funny little things in life. And suddenly people had the confidence to go to Girl Guides, which they hadn't had before. Or they took up a sport or a hobby, or they suddenly had friends. I would notice after 3 classes, 3 weeks, that their physicality would change quite significantly. And they looked taller and slimmer and looked different. And I actually looked for those changes in people. So I realized that by spending very little time in a perfect environment, you could really impact how people functioned in the non-perfect world. And for me, I suppose the big debate is that people that I'm working with now who are struggling in the system and have whatever challenges which we're going to talk about, they don't care what happens after they finish school or what happens in 10 years' time or whether what other people I work with or what other countries. So there's always an element for me between balancing those two things, and both camps don't care about each other, so it's up to me to have very distinct lines at this stage. I'd like to show this map. It's quite deliberately a mess, okay? I find it quite hilarious when students come to me and they think they're going to pick a career and travel from point A to point B. That doesn't happen, okay? My school headmaster in a talk I remember said that I would probably have 40 jobs in my lifetime. I don't think I quite have 40 yet, but a big part of me is that I do tend to reinvent and continue to develop, and I don't think that you can work in education with students and expect them to do that if you don't do that yourself. And also, you have to give the team space to do that. So they've gone on with their lives as well. Some of them got married, had their first marriages, their first babies, the first person's bought their first house, they've got PhDs, postdocs, they've gone to different countries, and they float away and they come back. So that's a big part of the project as well. So for me, all the experience that I've gained throughout my life has given me little nuggets. So I actually had my first teaching job when I was 12. I found myself in a boxing club in Baldoyle teaching 16-year-olds how to make pottery frogs when I was 12. And I realized, I can do this. It's actually not quite good at this, and I'm not too terrified, and actually they're listening to me, and they've all made frogs. And so that was my first experience, really, of teaching. And I traveled around all of the projects in North County Dublin, all the summer schools, and I found myself studying the differences in students between the different areas and the different groups. So that should have been an indication to me as to where I was going to end up. I went to Galway to study marine science. The reason I went to Galway was because I love the arts festival and I love Mockness. And when I finished my degree, I actually spent 3 months at Mockness. I can safely say they were the best 3 months of my life. And I worked with people from Brazil, Japan, Mexico, throughout the world, who had all come to mock this for the summer. We basically started work about 10 o'clock in the morning, finished at 3 o'clock in the morning, the next morning, and did that all again on rotate loop for, I think, 6 days a week, and was then in the parade. I then went over to Southampton. During my degree, I had actually got work experience in Southampton University, and I actually ended up working as a research scientist from my second year of my degree. I rang them up, I asked them for work experience, I'd done a variety of other work experience there along the way, and they said, oh, it's okay, we'll give you a job, you know, which I couldn't quite imagine. That was a really pivotal moment for me. It was the first time that it didn't matter that I was dyslexic, that I was actually seen to be able to work as a functioning research scientist, and my spelling ability no longer mattered. I'm really glad that I went to the UK to do my PhD. I recommend everybody to do their degree somewhere different to, the, you know, if they're moving on to masters and PhDs. I think you gain a huge amount of experience. In my case, I was lucky enough to be sent to Oxford and Cambridge. I was lucky enough to be sent to the European Space Agency to teach for them. Again, I found myself in a room teaching people older than me who were actually postdoctoral researchers, and being a little bit scared about that. I was sent to sea for a month. It was the worst environment I have ever been in. I didn't sleep for longer than 2 hours consecutively any night. I was beside the wind shaft on the boat. There was an alarm in the engine room that went off day and night. I got used to, I couldn't understand why we were sailing out of the port in Southampton while everything was actually being nailed down to the desk with big ropes. When we went around the corner of Cork, I found out that the only thing that wasn't nailed down was me and my chair. You actually got used to catching your workstation as you went past on the boat. You know, you knew you were going to have a good morning when you got out of bed and you hit the far wall. It was an extreme environment. I learned an awful lot about myself. I learned just how I can actually work in the worst environment possible. There was no space, no peace, no quiet, all the things that were wrong for me. I then came back. I had a lot of difficulty in convincing people that actually I wanted a job in education. I wasn't just coasting to get a postdoc. But along the way, I had found that I cared far more about students. And so when I went to Griffith College, I found myself working predominantly with students from India, Pakistan, China. And that gave me a huge insight into how different international students think and some of the challenges in that. And to look at it as a whole. When I moved back to Ireland, I didn't actually have any friends in Dublin. I never had any friends in school. I went to Galway and set up a life in Galway. And one of the ways that I made friends was I started working in theatre. And simultaneously, I got a job in Griffith while working as a sound op in theatre. I don't quite know how. I found I wasn't good with heights, so I went into sound instead of lights. And so I would find myself working on shows because the busiest times of the year were September for the Fringe Festival and college starting, so it was a bit of a nuts experience. But what theatre taught me was how you work in group dynamics with people. And after spending time in the academic world, where it takes 25 years for people to contemplate making a change, a show goes up in 4 days, quite effortlessly. The people will do all the rehearsals backstage, but within a few hours, you will go in and bring all the elements together. And that speed was incredible. And also, I used a lot of those people to teach my own teachers and to do a lot of group facilitation. And to a lot of my teaching team came from aspects of those people or friends of friends. So it opened up a whole world to me. And I ended up being technical director for a festival as well while I still had a full-time job too. So you get a sense of the sort of crazy person I am. Right, so to go back, right, so I was an observational scientist, right? I remember sitting in an oceanography lecture and being fascinated by the fact that we could measure the top of the sea, and the way that it wobbled up and down was actually what was on the seafloor. And I remember thinking, oh, that's really cool. Well, that's kind of how I look at students then, right? Because we only ever look at the effects. We only ever look at the things that are happening on the surface. We never look down deep to see what's actually causing those effects, and what's the ripple, you know, what's really happening. So I'd like you to take a second here, right? I have a list here in a minute. Just run through in your head all the top things you think of the challenges and the problems with any condition. sort of got a list in her head? Okay, so I have a list here. Right, these are some of the things that people come to me for. Anxiety, depression, they find it difficult to understand feelings, focus, they can't concentrate, or they can only concentrate on things that they like. They find it difficult to make eye contact. They're complete perfectionists to the point of being completely limiting themselves. They're very set in their ways. They struggle in school. Many of them drop out of school. A lot of people I work with have spent a considerable amount of time in their bedroom. They misunderstand questions, and they don't have any structure. They're always told to expand answers. They lack confidence. There's violent outbursts. They're overwhelmed. They're hugely sensitive in terms of in all areas of sensitivity. They're taking an enormous amount of information. They have a very literal sense of English, and in general, they don't really do well at school. Okay, so that's a list. Okay, and I could expand on the list of my own challenges as a dyslexic. You know, I don't know my left and my right. I still don't. For me, I needed a different approach to that. It wasn't enough to say to myself, well, these are all the things that are happening and all the things that are wrong. And sometimes you kind of wonder with people. I describe the people I work as onion people. Okay, you have to peel back the layers. And the order that you peel the layers back really matters too. So you still have to sit down and think about that. And I think this really came to light for me. There was a kind of a real turning point in the homework club where I took on two students, and they were both dyslexics. They were brother and sister. They were in the same home. They had the same teachers. They'd gone to the same school. They had the same doting grandmother that was paying for their tuition to come to me. And one of them, I gave her a little bit of help, and she rocketed very quickly. And everything just slotted into place. She started secondary school, and she was a straight A student. And she reminded me hugely of myself. Her brother, we gave him so much more support, and he always still struggled. And I was always like, what is it? Like, what's the difference? Why is no two people that I work with the same? And I'm going to start to talk a bit about how I basically started to look at personality and to look at the impacts of that. So I always say that I don't work with labels, I work with people. And I need a reason for that list. It's not good enough for me when I read that, oh, expand your answers. Or when I had on my school reports, oh, spelling and writing very poor. You don't say, like, you know, right? It's not good enough for someone to say, oh, she's very anxious, and you know, she doesn't do anything, or she doesn't go anywhere, or she's afraid to meet people, or he never understands my point of view. You know, it's just not enough to read that list. I need the reasons, and I need a way to help it, and I need a way to change it. But I always take the words of the people I work with, and one student I've been working with, some people get a really good sense of what I do. And she said to me that you manage to see the world as I see it, but you manage to communicate to me the way I need to be communicated to for me to get that. And so that's what I do, okay? So I see how she sees the world, I see her personality, and then I see how I need to tell her that so that she can do certain things. And she says to me, oh, you always know exactly what I've been missing, okay? So one of the fears of the moment is that she won't start her lab work, because she's a complete perfectionist, and I'm going, you have to start your lab work, right? But how are we going to get you to do that, okay? One aspect of this, and this is what those two students, those brother and sister, that was the pivotal difference, was that one of them was introverted and the other one was extroverted, right? And if you're introverted, you set very high standards for yourself. Your benchmarks are all internal. It doesn't matter what I think of your result. It'll only ever be good enough if you think it's good enough. If you're an extrovert person, you will tell me your grade in relation to everybody else in the room. You'll sit there and say, oh, so-and-so got that, and so-and-so got that, and so-and-so got that, and I was third from the bottom, and I was in there, so I'm really not happy, even though everybody in the room got 70%, okay? So their sense of themselves is always through being an extrovert. And And that's only one of the factors for me. There's a lot of them, and when you start to put them together, then you start to get a very complicated picture. But I've managed to make it simple for myself because I've been sort of charting this. I keep a lot of very detailed notes in the background. So I'm just making sure I haven't missed anything. Right. One of the really interesting assumptions for me about AS is that you're not all introverted. Over half of the personalities in the world can be given a diagnosis of Asperger's syndrome. I've charted that now. And some of the people who struggle the most, and the people struggle the most to understand, are the people who are actually extroverts. And there's a number of groups. So that's first of all, we make a lot of assumptions based on the stereotypes. And we don't, that's what I mean by we only looking at the surface. We think that if they find social interaction difficult, or they find eye contact difficult, that makes you an introvert. That's not what an introvert is. And my way of describing that is that if you can imagine that you have a battery pack, and you go through the day, and different things happen, you need a way to recharge that battery. And the introverted student will always come in and go to their bedroom first thing and take time out, right? The extrovert person will go and find the loudest environment to be in, and they'll like the team sports, and they've recharged that way. If you're in the workplace, you know, I can be highly introverted, I can stand up and do this, but at the end of the day, I will need to go and spend time on my own. I won't be finding the loudest place to go to tonight. And if I did go out, I'll probably be going out with only a few close people that I know very well. So that's a very important thing to understand, because it's a very important coping strategy. And it changes. You don't just go from friends and no friends. So suddenly it's a positive thing, positive way of looking at something. One of the challenges, one of the ironies with personalities is that people never know themselves. Some people know themselves fantastically, right? But sensing people always tell me that they're not sensing. And so I don't use a questionnaire, right? What I have devised over the last 7 years, the way that I do things, is that I have a series of exercises, and going back to my observational training, I observe how people process and do those exercises. So for me, what I'm looking at is the overlap between your personality and how you process the world. And there's a direct correlation between those two things now. And certain personalities always process the world in a certain way, and they always tell me that they're not sensing, right? And there's great contradictions in people. Like, there's people who have bedrooms that look like a bomb site, but they need a huge amount of structure and routine in their lives. And you wouldn't think that to look at their bedrooms or to look at the way that they dress. They'll probably marry everything they hate now. You know, I find that quite entertaining, that I can look at the trajectory of what sort of things people need in their lives. Some people, some personalities, particularly boys, need a really strong woman in their life. And actually, if they marry somebody similar to the mother, they do really well, and they don't have half the vices they would have if they didn't do that. Other people, their father figure matters hugely in their world. And that's what I mean by that cauldron full of ingredients that I wasn't getting the full picture of in the homework club. I needed to start to look at that in a bigger sense. And this, you know, this for me, right, Ireland, predominantly the two biggest ways that we process information is auditory and kinesthetic. And from very young ages, we used to be told to sit down and shut up and be quiet. So that's not very helpful, okay? So first of all, you need to move around the room. I'll explain kinesthetic in the next slide. Auditory people don't just need to listen, they need to ask questions. So it doesn't help for you to be told to be quiet. And then for me, there's a sense of balancing the room, because I have to take people's personalities into account. And there's a huge amount of articles online now about incorporating introverted learners into the classrooms. And there's this idea that introverted people can't do group work. They can if you give them the right role. They just can't do it if they don't have a role and they don't know what's expected of them. So when I run a workshop, because I go back to my own literacy difficulties, I'm not going to be the reader, I'm not going to be the writer, I actually hand out less paper to people, so someone has to be the reader, one person has to be in the group, one person gets a pen, so one person's the writer. They don't all have to do it, because they can't all do it. And one person's going to stand up and tell me what the group did, and that person will be the person who's really good at presenting themselves, right? And so they've all found their role, and they've all found their little thing, and so everybody's happy, okay? I suppose one of the differences of what I did in the homework club, and I had this rule, this school corridor principle, right? If I go into a conventional school, quite often if I stand in the corridor, the only voice I'll hear is the teacher speaking. If I stood in the homework club, I heard everything, right? Everybody was talking, everybody was laughing. The furniture was probably being moved around. They actually wrote on the furniture. You know, we devised the tables so they could be whiteboards. And for instance, the reason we did that was because we had hearing impaired students, and if you're a teacher and you stand and you write on a whiteboard, you always have to turn your back at some point. So if I write on the table, you don't have to turn your back. So that's what I mean by you start to think about how you're going to incorporate people and how you're going to think about things and how you're going to balance the room. I joke this is my most misspelled word, kinesthetic. The spell checker seems to come up with something random every time, right? Kinesthetic, what is it? This quote for me is taken on, I love theatre and I love dance, my favourite group for Cush Gang. And one film I've seen twice is a documentary called Pinna about Pinna Bush. And she really got a sense of what kinesthetic was, and it's really interesting to listen to all of her dancers. She worked with them for years and years, and she mentored them and brought the best out of them. And they all say, oh, she gave me a way to express myself. I didn't have the words before I met her. You know, so this is a sense of why it matters so much how someone processes the world. So kinesthetic is feelings and experiences, and it's needing to move, and it's a sense of remembering stuff. Like, you can remember that sports game, you can remember every shot you took and who you passed the ball to, but you can't remember your poetry because nobody's taught you how to look at it in a kinesthetic way, okay? So suddenly, if we make people actually look at the material in the way that suits them, suddenly they can remember them. So that's what I always said to people, that an hour with us was worth 3 years better, you know? Because suddenly, I make you do things in a way that you really get. And that's why your personality and the way you process the world matters. The list went out the window ages ago. I don't care about what you can't do. I only care about what you can. I sometimes ask myself, why is education not changed more? I haven't got a clock, and I forgot to reset the timer. How am I doing time? What's it now?
20 minutes to 11.
10:40. Great, okay. I can't do maths on my head, that's what I was trying to wonder. it's one of the things I can't do in my head, so I was wondering how much time I had left. Why is the world not changed, okay? And I heard this really cool story, right? So, I wondered why everybody was afraid of reading, you know? Like, I can read now, but I still don't feel I can read because I can't stand up and read out loud to you. So why do I think that reading is reading out loud? So, there were these some people sitting down to Sunday dinner, and the wife had cooked the Sunday roast, and she chopped the ends off the roast. And so husband turned and said, "Yeah, why do you chop the ends off the roast?" "Oh, because my mother always cooked that way." And so her grandmother was sitting at the table and said, "Why did she do that?" She said, "Well, I don't know, I just always done that. My mother did that." And she was still alive, she was a nursing home, so they rang her up and said, "You know, why did you always chop the ends off the roast?" Right? And then, "Oh, because then my tin was too small." Right? So we have three generations of people doing the same thing because of what they grew up with, right? And school sometimes feels like that to me, okay? I find it hugely frustrating when people kind of project their own experiences onto little people. I've met little people, you know, of only 5, and I've only been in school a couple of months, and they really hate it, and they're really terrified. And a big part of that is, you hear stories of like, "Oh, well, I always used to feel really stupid in school, and I didn't want him to feel stupid, so, you know, I was really like pushing him to do extra sheets." But he never got any sheets finished, so he does feel stupid, okay? You know, so there's a big sense for me that we're always following patterns. I'm not very good at following those. So I kind of threw the rule book out the window. But I do understand the importance of that. And so, interestingly, most of my teachers are first generation to university. So their families think education really matters, and it's very important, and they've all strived to get there. But they weren't straight A students. They really had to struggle to work and to do well. And in the end, they kind of blossomed towards the end and found their forte, and they're really brilliant at whatever it is that they do. But they weren't straight A students. They didn't learn everything off. They didn't grow up in a home where everybody did brilliantly academically. There isn't generations of that behind them. And so they understand when people find something hard, and they look for a way to help them to make it easier because they understand that it's hard. And sometimes the sort of people, not always, there's brilliant teachers out there, but sometimes when people drift into teaching, they've come from the straight A home. And there's a big track record of that there. And they have a different outlook. And so that's what I mean by it matters generationally what has happened. I always find this one hilarious, right? So every parent that talks to me wants their child to be confident and happy. Always comes up in the conversation, right? And I find it really funny that after a few weeks when I ring up and I check in, they go, oh, the confidence has really come on. I was like, yeah, that's why it's called confidence club, you know. Right? And I sometimes sit and go, like, how did I do that? And basically, right, I give people a sense of who they are, right? This is a big part of the session, right? I give them a sense of awareness who they are. I make sure, especially with the smaller people that come to me, that they manage to do everything in the session, even if I have to give them 50 ways to get to the answer until they get it themselves. I make sure they've actually left the session having been able to achieve everything, because sometimes that's the first time they've ever managed to do that. And I did 3 psychological assessments myself, so I know how difficult it is because you focus on everything that someone can do. And it's a very traumatic experience, and I still remember the trauma from when I was 4 when I did my first assessment. It's still there in the back of my mind. So I've given people a sense of who they are. They've managed to do things because they've given it to them a way that they can actually do it. And then they can try anything. You teach them how to apply that to everyday life. And suddenly, yeah, I feel really good in myself. So they do feel confident, and then they feel happy because they're doing one. I knew I wasn't gonna remember what this slide was about. Yes, I remember. Okay, I started moving to the question of what do I do and how do I explain that to people, okay? Because it's really difficult. So I thought I'd read out some of the words of parents, because I actually asked them recently, you know, a few people, what am I going to say here? One parent said that I have this mind-reading ability, which is somehow comforting and terrifying at the same time. They feel like I've totally got them. I give them a reason for the difficulty, and at the same time, it's no big deal. We're going to talk about expectation in a minute. I give people a plan and a roadmap. I'm a very practical person. I did a very practical PhD. My PhD was about taking data sets and being able to do something with them. It has to be highly practical for me. He felt that you had normalized everything within him that he previously felt made him abnormal. So it's a sense of who you are. And I really like this one. I'm going to read out both sides of the card. He gave us permission not to force him down a path of hoops and fire-breathing dragons. We didn't have to wait for a result, and that was important at the time. The results have to happen very quickly for me. There is a too good to be true quality to the experience that I have no doubt some jaded parents will struggle to understand. For others, the hardest part will be to give up control and believe in magic. And it's funny, Aileen was saying that, you know, they sometimes just tell people I do wizardry. Magic does come up. But there is a plan and a structure in the background, and there's a formula, and people fit into it. I sometimes wonder, has school got harder? Have the stories got harder? And because I do work with adults in the business world, and I see their personalities, and I see the personality of somebody at 35, and I see what they've managed to achieve, and I look at the personality of someone who's 15 that I'm working with, and I wonder, has the system gotten more difficult? In a way, it kind of has, because what I always notice with the 35-year-olds is that they managed to drift under the radar. They managed to stay under the surface, actually, and just drift down through it. And it was easier for them to have positive experience along the way. It was easier for them to get work experience. That's becoming more difficult now. It was easier to go out and do things at a younger age, like the sort of things that I did. And those kind of have a balancing impact, so that if you don't do very well in school, you don't feel like you made friends, but yet you might be working in a job and getting on better with adults and older people from you. And so that balance is there. And sometimes I think that balance isn't there so much now. And if you shine a spotlight on someone and on all the things that are wrong with them, I think at certain ages and for certain personalities, that's very difficult to cope with. So in some ways, I think the system has got harder. Students always correct me. I tell them there's no right answer, and they go, "What do you mean there's no wrong answer?" I'm like, "No, there's no right answer, right? I just want your answer." And that's what I mean about I set up a series of tasks, and I want you to approach the task and try it and do it in your way. And then I get how you work. And I don't need the right answer, I just need your answer. And parents are always cutting in, going, because they spend so much time with their child being misrepresented, they're kind of like, "Oh no, you've done that wrong now. No, say that again. Like, you know, it's not quite the right answer I was looking for." I don't care what the answer is. I try to give people what my own parents didn't have. When I write my reports, I write them for the students to read. I write them hugely positive. I still have my psychological assessment one from when I was 16. The most ridiculous part for me was when I had to hand it in for my PhD. Because I told them I wasn't going for another one, they just, you know, like it or love it. And it basically said that to go to university was above my status, and that I was trying to do things way beyond my means, and that I wouldn't ever achieve. It was just too difficult for me. And they were reading this, and I got a first in university. So they were kind of looking, they're going, I said, "Yeah, just don't worry about it, just put it in the file." I said, "You need one on file so I could have the software? We'll just do that." It's to give people that sense of objectivity. And when I write in reports, it's sometimes the small, funny little things that I write, the throwaway comments that have a massive impact on people. And I'm very aware of that, and I take time to write them and to make sure they're hugely positive. If there's things I need to say that are negative, I'll always say them separately. One of the things I didn't realize when I started the homework club that would be very difficult for me was that I was going to work through all my worst nightmares from the age of 4 till mid-20s, within 18 months. And I'll be perfectly honest, quite a lot of cases made me cry, and some still do. But one thing, a lot of people have wanted me, a lot of organizations have wanted me to go on speaking tours and talk about my own experience, and I never do. And I do have a podcast, and I always keep it very positive, right? And the reason I do that is because the students do the silly little things I set them to do, the 10-minute exercises that don't seem like rocket science. They do that because they believe they can be me. And they believe that they can have my achievements. And so I might tell them that I hated school, or that wasn't very positive, or I might allude to some of the things that were difficult for me, but I don't dwell on my own sob story, and I never will. It's just not who I am. But I do see all of my experiences in people that I work with. And this brings me on to this. This is why this is so important for me. Lack of expectation is the massive enemy out there, okay? There was no expectation of me. I had this Jekyll and Hyde existence. At home, I could do everything. My parents were hugely supportive. They told me I could rock the world. Outside of the system, I always thought I could never do anything. For some personalities, that's hugely destructive, because I believe what you tell me. People describe it as either character crushing or character building. One of my students said that to me in the homework club. And I sort of thought, yeah, well, why is that? See, because I always ask the question, why, right? And some personalities, the best way to get me to do anything was to tell me I couldn't do it. But for some people, when you tell them you can't do it, they don't do anything. So one of the biggest problems is that with a diagnosis and with any label comes a lack of expectation. And a lot of parents I talk to, they're sort of like, "Oh, I was worried about putting too much pressure." It's not pressure, it's just you're imagining. You put someone up on a pedestal, and you get back from people what you imagine from them. A big sense of achievement in others is knowing they can do it before they do. And so it's hugely important to believe in people and to have that expectation. That's not pressure, that's belief. One thing I've noticed is that there is a massive correlation between people doing well in school and "my teacher hates me," right? I'm not sure their teacher does hate them, but they think their teacher hates them. But for a lot of personalities, if I feel my teacher doesn't like me, I don't do well in the subject. So people have very simple needs, and I realized this very quickly in the homework book, where they turned around and said, "I'm liked here, people like me." That's huge. They have a sense of purpose and they know where they belong. I always get people to set goals. And I'm always looking at a trajectory when I write the reports of where I can see people being with their personality and their talents. I can see beyond in the distance. Everybody's going, oh, they're only 10, like, stop, you know, right? I think it's really important to see that horizon and to work towards it. Right, we all know respect is huge. For me, it's like energy. I go back to my physics training, I'm a physicist. I think if people study physics, they behave better in the world, right? Because they'd understand the reactions to things and the cause and effect. But what I think is interesting when I started to think about this is respect is funny little things for me. Like, a lot of the people that I work with are highly sensitive, so I make sure that my nails are always clean, because I'm going to point to stuff on paper. I make sure that my breath doesn't have a smell of it. I make sure to turn up and to be the person that person needs me to be. And that's a big part of the teachers that I pick. And if someone turns out to me, oh, I'm not sure what they thought of me, or I don't care what they thought of you, how are they? Okay? So, and I do pick a huge amount of introverted teachers, funny enough, because they're always looking at the other person. They're not looking at themselves always. And so I look for people with that sense of intuition and objectivity. It's very important. And that's what respect is to me. Okay. So I've always felt like an idiot. One of the biggest challenges for me is that there's no box I go in. And when I started on this journey, it was very hard to explain to people what I do differently. And I needed to open the school because I needed people to take a chance on me. And then by people coming to me and working with me and getting a result, they then talk to their friends and send more people to me. But it's very hard for me to explain, and even we're on the second last slide now, I think. It's very hard for me to tell people what I do. I look at who people are, I understand them, I explain that to them, and I give them a roadmap on how to do things in the way that suits them. But that's an incredibly difficult box to go into. And I can now predict with personalities, I can predict what their learning style is. I can predict with personalities whether they're going to be given a diagnosis of AS, ADHD, whether they're going to self-harm, whether they'll have depression, anxiety. It's a whole list, whole array of things that I can, whether they'll have an auditory processing disorder. But I'm terrified of giving that list. I don't want there to be another questionnaire out there that people do and take off. And I used to think that when Binet created the IQ test that he'd probably be swivelling in his grave at how it's used. But I realised recently, he actually set it up to be a scale of IQ, to put people into boxes, to decide what they were capable of, not just to decide how to help them. And so I have a big fear about talking about the nuts and bolts of my work, and talking about the nitty gritty of what I actually do. It's so difficult. It's such a massive fear for me because I need to take the me factor out of what I do. But in order to take the me factor out, I need to put out the purple profiling, the way that I sit and I observe people and the way that they work through things. I need to put out the template of what certain personalities need in order to achieve. I need to put out the template of why they have that condition and why they end up with five labels rather than one, and one person will only end up with one. Because I can now understand all those things and see the patterns, but I still don't have the answers on how to talk about it. Why do I do this? For me, it's about literacy and intelligence not being in the same sentence. I did all of the academic things I've done in my life to make myself feel whole because everybody told me that I couldn't. And I hate the way that we combine literacy and intelligence and we make all these big assumptions about it. And a lot of that is back to that generational blueprint. In the past, people who were wealthy could read and people who weren't couldn't. And so there's a lot of big associations and big assumptions around it. But it's important for me to keep in my head why I do this. And I now realise that approximately 30% of people who start the school system every year, for some reason, are going to have some difficulty. And that's a lot of people, and they don't need to, because I can give them a different way to learn maths, or to learn to read, or to do the things that they worry about, the kind of core skills. And so that's the way I do what I do. So we're going to finish up on this. Personality is an inconvenience in school. I said that a long time ago, very quickly after I did the homework club. I realised that I actually like all the people I work with, you know, and I can see something great in them all. They've all got a purpose in the world. They've all got a role to play. They're all different. I tend to meet the rarer percentages of people. That's just the way that it works out, because they don't fit in a box. And everybody's trying to fit in a box and trying to be the same. And that is why, for me, that the personality of the person that I work with makes so much more difference than the label in how I get a result. Thank you.